Hey, Pastor Steve Waldron, Dennis Prager, I really enjoy the PragerU videos a lot, little 5-minute deals. And he came out with the Rational Bible. I just picked this up in an Ollie's haul for $9.99. I'm very grateful I didn't order it for however much, 20-something bucks off Amazon when it came out. Didn't have the money anyhow, but I did have this. It's, let's see, it retails for $34.99. So let's read a little bit about Dennis Prager. Before there was ever PragerU and all this, I used to listen to him on the radio. Okay, he's led a unique life with a daily radio talk show heard around America and around the world. He has talked to literally millions of people for 35 years. He's traveled to 130 countries, 50 American states, has lectured on all 7 continents, conducts symphony orchestras. Now that's one thing I didn't know about Dennis Prager till we're reading this right now. Is a best-selling author of 7 books and is founder of the online nonprofit Prager University's 5-minute educational videos are viewed around the world more than 500 million times a year. And this is put out by Regenery Faith, Henry Regenery, big name in conservative publishing. And so this cover, now let's say if we're going to do a review, we're going to look at the whole thing. It is absolutely gorgeous. This is stunning. I'm going to let Sister Francesca zoom in on that again. And the Rational Bible, you know, he argues in a certain sense, not just here, but in many things, that Judeo-Christian values are just the best way to have freedom and blessing for the most number of people. And so this came out in 2018. It was kind of a big deal when it came out, you know, him and Ben Shapiro, big in the conservative movement. Now, it's 520 pages total, and that includes the notes and of the Bible itself. It's kind of like a commentary. It's 511 pages. And it says here too, it says all scripture taken from the New JPS translation, Jewish Publication Society, 1985, used by permission, published in the United States of America, which is a good thing. So let me just let you look at the table of contents so you can kind of see what you're getting. So this was $9.98 at Ollie's. I have not checked eBay, thrift books on eBay, Goodwill, other sources on eBay or Amazon, how much you can get it for. But I knew $9.98 was a good price. And I've had this for a few weeks now. I've just had it in a stack. If you could only see what I'm surrounded with to do on here. So why this commentary? Who is the Torah commentary for? To Jewish readers, to Christian readers, to non-religious readers. The Torah is not man-made. See, I love that. Man-made or God-made, why it matters. How was the Torah transmitted? Reason, Torah, and God. Why read this commentary? Did the Exodus happen? A few details. BC or BCE, God is He. On how to read this commentary, the use of post-biblical Jewish sources. Now, that's all just like in the preface. The Torah gives the midwives' names, but not Pharaoh's. See, that's just amazing stuff. Now, years ago, I started reading like Jewish commentaries on the Torah, and I was shocked at the insight that the Jewish scholars had on certain things. And, you know, I guess they've been studying it for so many centuries that there is a lot of wisdom passed down. I hope I'm not going too fast there, Sister Francesca. But it is just amazing some of the comments and the observations they had. In just a few moments, we're going to just read some of the commentary that is in here, God's slavery and freedom, because obviously this is a huge jailbreak. As a matter of fact, to the African-American community, as you study history, that they looked to the story of Exodus for much of their jailbreak from horrific slavery in the United States of America, one of the blights on the United States of America. America is a great country. It's done, you know, the most good for the most people than most countries do, but it's not perfect. It's not the New Jerusalem, you know what I'm saying? So we're thankful that things are in the process being rectified. And so it continues on, and it says to sue, literal translation, Genesis 2:18, it is not good for man to be alone. I will make him a helper who is his equal. So we're just going to look at, we're going to start at Exodus 2:14, and the translation, and then read some of the commentary. It says, he retorted, who made you chief and ruler over us? Do you mean to kill me as you killed the Egyptian? Moses was frightened and thought, then the matter is known. When Moses asked the Hebrew offender why he hit his fellow, the man did not respond to the question. Instead, he verbally attacked Moses. This is a classic response of guilty people when challenged about what they've done, to attack their accuser. See, that's amazing observations of human nature right there. That's what I was telling somebody earlier today. One reason I believe the Bible is true, even Sister Aldrin's father, is because it doesn't seek to make heroes out of anybody but Jesus, who's God in flesh, but everybody else is presented in all of their humanity. And even Jesus doesn't act sometimes the way we would kind of think he, I mean, he's knocking over tables, making whips, he's just doing some things here. All right, 2:15, when Pharaoh learned of the matter, he sought to kill Moses, but Moses fled from Pharaoh. He arrived in the land of Midian and sat down beside a well. Given that Moses was raised at the royal court, we might have thought he would have be spared punishment for killing a mere overseer. But killing an Egyptian overseer and identifying with the Hebrews would have branded him as a traitor and warranted a death penalty. Fair point. 2:17. Because there's no commentary on 2:16. But shepherds came and drove them off. Moses rose to their defense, and he watered their flock. For the third time, Moses refuses to tolerate the evil he sees around him. See, that's a great point. This time, he does not kill or speak out. He simply stands in defense of Midianite women. The third event demonstrates Moses is not simply a Hebrew nationalist concerned with fighting evil only when Hebrew is the victim, and he is offended by injustice toward women as men. In the first instance, he intervenes when a non-Hebrew oppresses a Hebrew. In the second instance, he intervenes when one Hebrew wrongs another Hebrew. And now he intervenes when non-Hebrew men oppress non-Hebrew women. All injustice infuriates him and prompts him back. So very fair points, especially in the national discussion that we sometimes have. I'm skipping up to 14:10, kind of during the Exodus, the Passover. And a little side note, it says, many people are uncomfortable being morally judged and especially uncomfortable with God who judges them. And then it's got an essay, why didn't the Torah abolish slavery? Essay, without standards, everything good will fail. See, some neat, neat stuff there. So, let me just, why no fire on the Sabbath? Let me just show you what an average page. The print is good. It just printed so well, so elegant. This is something that people be proud to own. You know, one thing I miss is it doesn't have a ribbon marker, which would have been a nice thing. And let's see if it's Smith's own. We're going to see if it lays flat in the first part. I can't really tell. It's too close. Yeah, it's definitely Smith's own book. So it's excellent, excellent quality. Here's, I'm just going to compare it with my, and we know it's not a regular Bible. It's like a commentary is what it is. And it's a commentary / Judeo-Christian founding of America morals type thing. But this will just give you an idea. So it's not the type of thing you'd necessarily take to church with you. It's more that you would read. And more than a theological commentary, it's more of an observational and a lifestyle commentary, which is still excellent. So, and my understanding is he's got Genesis out now, which I don't have, and God is good. I'll talk with you later in Jesus' name.